Hey, Life Church Huntsville, welcome to our micro midweek service. I have the distinct privilege and honor of sharing the final micro midweek devotion of 2020. We hope you've enjoyed these broadcasts over the last several weeks. We hope something that's been said has been a blessing to you and has ministered to you in a very personal and powerful way. We hope you've enjoyed this content as much as we've enjoyed making it for you. But I have the privilege of sharing the word tonight, so I want to get right into this word. I believe God has something special He wants to say to each and every one of you. Hebrews chapter 12, beginning in verse 1 through verse 2. If you don't have a Bible, you can follow along on the screen with us. I'll be reading from the ESV translation of the Bible tonight. It says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded..." Come on, just say that word with me, surrounded. Go ahead and comment in the chat section the word surrounded. "Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God." I want to talk to you tonight from the subject, "You are surrounded." Let me pray for us really quickly. Father, we love you. We thank you for this time together in your word. I pray that through this online format, you would use this to speak to your people, that you would use me as your vessel, Lord God, to communicate life change to the hearts and lives of your people. For all that you do, we'll be so careful to give you the praise in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people said, amen and amen. If I had to choose a word to adequately describe how this past year has made so many of us feel, it would be the word surrounded. 2020 is a year that has made us feel surrounded. Seems like every time we turned around this year, there was another crisis, there was another problem, there was another dilemma, there was another tragedy. It just made us wonder what else could possibly go wrong this year. Somebody even coined the phrase, "Well, it's 2020, and that's kind of become synonymous with, "Well, anything's possible." And that's been the kind of year that it's been. I don't know about you, but this year has made me want to apologize, if I could, to any previous year that I've ever complained about. I want to go back to 2019, say, "2019, I am so sorry I ever complained about you. You weren't actually that bad after all. 2018, I'm so sorry. You were actually pretty amazing. And if I could go back, I would in a heartbeat." But we, of course, can't do that. But this year, we have felt surrounded unlike any other year. Surrounded by sickness. Before this year, most of us have never even heard the word coronavirus. And now hardly a day goes by where we don't hear the word coronavirus or COVID-19, or as some of us have nicknamed it, the Rona. And so I don't know about you, but I've been more conscious and aware of my breathing and washing my hands and my personal hygiene and how close I'm getting to people more than I ever have ever in my life. And, you know, now there's that awkward moment when you see someone that you know or a friend or somebody from church and you don't know whether to reach out and shake their hand or hug their neck or wave or fist bump. It's just that awkward moment when you see people, you don't know where people are in this whole thing. We've been surrounded by tragedy. Almost all of us know someone who's passed away due to sickness. In fact, just this week, we sadly got word of somebody very close to our church who passed away due to complications with COVID. It's been a sad year in many ways. We've been surrounded by negativity. It seems like every time you turn on the news, there's another negative news story about something else going wrong in the world. And just when you think it couldn't get any worse, it seemingly does. Some people are saying it's going to get better. Other people are saying it's never going to get better. We've been surrounded by social and political unrest. This has been the most volatile year that we've ever seen on a social and political level. This group is hostile towards that group. This side of the political aisle is throwing stones on that side of the political aisle. It's people can't get along. We've been surrounded by loss. People have lost their jobs. They've lost their businesses. They've lost their livelihood. They've lost their savings and they've lost their sense of normalcy. And worst of all, many of them have lost their hope. I mean, one of the worst things in the world is to lose hope. People are surrounded by worry. People are worried about their family. They're worried about the future. They're worried about what else may be potentially coming in 2021. This year has tested our faith and our resolve unlike any other year has. But I believe that this passage here in Hebrews that we just read about has some encouragement for us here today. Hebrews 12 and 1 confirms the fact that you are indeed surrounded, but not by COVID, not by tragedy, not by loss, not by negativity or worry, but by the heroes of faith who've gone on before us. Hebrews 12 and 1 says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us." The Bible here refers to these heroes of faith that you can read all about in Hebrews chapter 11. It refers to them as a cloud of witnesses that are surrounding us in our faith journey today. It talks about Abel, talks about Enoch, it talks about Noah, talks about Abraham and Isaac and Joseph and Moses and others that are surrounding us as a cloud of witnesses. Now, we don't really know how much of what goes on down here on earth that the saints up in heaven are actually aware of. I'm not saying that these saints in heaven are watching our every move somehow, but the Bible does seem to indicate in Luke 15:7 that there is rejoicing in heaven over those who repent and put their faith in Jesus. So it does seem to indicate that there's at least some awareness about in heaven of about what's happening down here on earth. But what we do know for sure is that these heroes of faith that have finished their race, that have gone on to be with the Lord in heaven, are surrounding us and are encouraging us by their examples, by the lives that they live, these lives of faith that they live. Through the pages of God's Word, their lives are constantly encouraging us and challenging us and pushing us to continue on, to press on, to persevere just as they did. The Believer's Bible Commentary says this about this passage in Hebrews 12 and 1. It says, "We must bear in mind that Hebrews was written to people who were being persecuted because they had forsaken Judaism for Christ. They were facing bitter opposition. There was a danger that they might interpret their suffering as a sign of God's displeasure, that they might be discouraged and give up. Worse of all, that they might be tempted to return to the temple and its ceremonies." I'm going to ask you a question tonight. Do you feel tempted to give up? Are you tempted to throw in the towel? Just as the audience of the book of Hebrews, are you tempted to interpret your sufferings as a sign of God's displeasure towards you, or even worse, of His absence in your life? Is there a part of you that is tempted to return to the way things maybe used to be? Are you tempted to go back to a former way of life and a former way of living because of how difficult this year has been? I want to encourage you tonight, don't give up. Don't quit. You've come way too far to turn back now. God has been too faithful. God has seen you this far, and He will continue to see you into the days, weeks, and months to come. He'll continue to be faithful and to see you through if you don't quit. If you don't give up, make no mistake about it. These heroes of faith that we read about in the Bible were no strangers to the feeling of being surrounded. I think about Moses and how Moses was surrounded by Pharaoh and surrounded by Pharaoh's army, the Egyptians, and how he was even at one point surrounded by the Red Sea and waves on either side of him, and how God used him and led him out of seemingly impossible situations. I think about Daniel in Daniel in the lion's den, and how he was surrounded by ferocious lions, and how God shut their mouths and preserved his life. I think about the Apostle Paul and how he was surrounded by trials and challenges of all kinds throughout his ministry, how he endured so much for the sake of the gospel. All of these saints knew what it felt like to be surrounded. But I want you to understand something tonight. God does His best work in our lives when we feel surrounded. I'm going to say that again. God does His best work in our lives when we feel surrounded. David said this in Psalm 23:5. He said, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies." Notice how he didn't say in the absence of my enemies, but in the presence of my enemies. He was basically saying, when my enemies, when my trials, when my trouble are all around me, God will set a table before me in their presence. See, you can't have the table without the trouble. The table and the trouble always go hand in hand. In fact, it's the trouble in our lives that creates the conditions for God to set a table before me and before you. In fact, if you're surrounded by trouble, get excited and get ready and start looking around for a table to pop up somewhere, because I believe the trouble in your life is an indication that God's about to set a table before you in the presence of your adversity. I believe that's coming. Start looking around for the table. A table is about to come up somewhere. If you want the table, then you've got to deal with the trouble. So really quickly, as I wrap this up tonight, what are we surrounded by? We talked about how we're surrounded by these cloud of witnesses, these saints who've gone before us to as examples and as encouragement in our daily lives through the pages of God's Word. What are we surrounded by? Number one, we're surrounded by saints who made it. Saints who made it. They made it. They finished their course. They crossed the finish line victoriously, and you can too. Let me say it this way. You will too. Look, go ahead and comment in the chat section. Say, "I will make it." Go ahead and say that. I will make it. Make that your daily affirmation. Every time you wake up and look at yourself in the mirror and say, "I will make it today." Sometimes we think of these Bible heroes as larger than life, superhuman beings who did these great exploits for God, but the truth is that they were regular, average, ordinary human beings just like we are. But the difference was that they depended upon an extraordinary God to see them through. The same spirit that was in them is in you today if you're a believer in Jesus. The same spirit that empowered them will also empower you. The same spirit that helped them will also help you in your time of need. I want to encourage you tonight, you can make it. You will make it. Why? Because you have to make it. What's the alternative? To give up, to turn around, to turn back? You can't turn back now. God has taken you this far, and he'll be faithful to continue to take you into the next season of your life. Go ahead and type in the chat section again. I will make it. I will make it. Number two, we are surrounded by saints who stayed faithful. Saints who stayed faithful. I want to encourage you, stay faithful in this season. Don't allow circumstances to cause you to pull back and pull away from the Lord or the things of God. Stay faithful in your devotional life. Stay in God's Word. Keep saturating your mind with God's Word, with the Scriptures. Renew your mind daily with God's Word. Keep pressing into prayer. Keep calling upon His name. Keep crying out to Him and He'll be faithful. Stay faithful with your serving. If you're serving on a team, keep showing up. Keep being a blessing to your church family. Keep being a blessing to your team. Keep being a blessing to other people. Stay faithful with your witness. Keep encouraging people. Keep telling others about the goodness of God. Keep telling people about Jesus when the opportunity presents itself. Invite people to come to church with you. Stay faithful in your witness. And finally, stay faithful in your giving. Keep giving of your resource. Keep being faithful in your giving. You know, it's tempting when we're going through difficulty to pull back on our giving and upon our generosity. Keep being faithful with your giving and God will be faithful to you. And number three, we're surrounded by saints who needed God's grace. Every one of these heroes of faith had moments in their life where they needed a little grace. Times where they blew it, times where they fell short, times where they were weak, times where they doubted, times where they lost their temper, times where they struggled, but God's grace was always there to see them through. I don't know about you, but this year I've needed a little bit of grace. I've needed grace from my family. I've needed grace from our pastoral staff. You know, we strive for excellence and we want to do everything with a certain level of quality, but sometimes we fall short. Sometimes we miss that mark and it can be frustrating. So I've needed some grace from the staff. They've needed grace in return. And we, thankfully, we have such an incredible team here. They get it. They understand our goal is excellence, but we're not always going to achieve that the way that we want to. But we've needed grace in this season. I want you to understand tonight that there is grace available for you in whatever season that you're in right now. In fact, the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 12 and 9, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." Guys, the truth is when you're weak, you're actually strong because God's grace will strengthen you. God's grace will be there to sustain you and to empower you in that season. Number four, and finally, we're surrounded by saints who kept their focus. I love how Hebrews 12 and 2 begins. It says, "Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith." And that is what we are called to do in the midst of difficulty and uncertainty, is to keep our eyes upon Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. Guys, listen, times will change. People will change. Circumstances will change. But Jesus will never change. He never will. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. You can't lose as long as your eyes are fixed upon the one who never changes. People will let you down. People will fail you, but Christ never will. Keep your eyes fixed upon Jesus. Stay focused upon Him. As I was thinking about how to close this message tonight, for whatever reason, this imagery came to mind. I always love those scenes in the movies and in the TV shows where you've got this one character who, for whatever reason, is barricaded in a building, completely surrounded by the police. The authorities have every door, every exit, every possible way of escape covered. They've got squad cars parked around the perimeter of the building. The lights are flashing. You may even have a helicopter that's hovering overhead and that's got a spotlight down. And the tension in the scene is building, wondering what this character is going to do. He's completely surrounded, completely out of options. Then you inevitably hear one of the officers with a bullhorn declare to the person inside, "We have the building completely surrounded. Come out with your hands up." At that point, the character knows that if he wants to make it out of this thing alive, he has no choice but to surrender. And I feel like telling someone watching tonight, if you want to make it out of 2020 alive, if you want to make it out victoriously, I should say, then you've got to come out with your hands up. You got to come out in total surrender to God. You've got to come out with a praise upon your lips. You've got to come out in faith saying, "God, I trust you. God, I praise you. God, I place my life and my situation in your hands. God, I'm powerless in and of myself. I surrender all to you." Having your hands lifted, it's a sign of surrender. It's a sign, it's a symbol of praise. It's a symbol of faith and trust in God. There's a song that we sing in church that says, "It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles." And I want you to know that as believers in Jesus, this is how we fight our battles. Not like the world fights their battles. We fight our battles differently. We fight our battles with praise. We fight our battles with worship. We fight our battles with surrender. We fight our battles with faith and confidence in God, with whom nothing is impossible. So I want to encourage you today, go out of 2020 with your hands held up. Go out of 2020 in total surrender. As we get ready to exit a very trying year, a year that has made us feel surrounded, I want to encourage you to come out with your hands up. And when you do, I believe that God will take notice and will move upon your behalf. Amen. I want to move now into a time of prayer. Hope that word has encouraged somebody watching. We do want to pray for your needs. If you have a specific need that you want us to pray for you about, please go ahead and send an email to prayer@lifechurchhuntsville.com, or you can comment with your prayer need in the chat section as you're watching tonight. And our team that's monitoring those will be sure to pray for each and every one of those. But I want to go before the Lord and ask God to bless your needs tonight. Father, we love you. God, I thank you for this opportunity to share your word with your people. God, I pray that you would use this word to speak life to your people who are watching today. God, meet every need. Those that are battling sickness, those that are struggling in their emotions, those that are struggling in their family, whatever the case might be, God, I pray that you would meet them right where they are. God, you're a faithful God. We trust you, and we just place our lives completely in your hands. We surrender all to you, to the one to whom nothing is impossible. And we thank you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. We also want to give you an opportunity to give tonight. As you've been hearing, we are on track to have our best financial year as a local church. It doesn't make any sense in the natural, but God, our God is faithful, and it's because of people like you who trusted the Lord with stewardship in your life. So we want to encourage you to give. Multiple ways to give here at Life Church Huntsville. You know this. You can mail in a check. You can give through our Life Church Huntsville app. You can give through our giving tool at lifechurchhuntsville.com/egiving. Whichever way you prefer to give, we know that it's going to find good soil, and that God will bless what you give to continue to help us to advance the gospel here in Huntsville and around the world. Thank you so much for tuning in tonight. Stay tuned for our time of reflection and prayer over the next 3 minutes. God bless.